Welcome to the YouTube channel of Equipus Taupo. We believe that 2020 is going to be the year of overflow, so we pray you are blessed by this message.
As I mentioned, we're doing a new series this morning. It's called Flex Your Faith. Flex Your Faith. Anyone want to take a stab at what that means? What it means to actually flex? Yeah, what does it mean to flex? Yeah, everyone's going like this. To flex your muscles, that's right. You can't probably read this down here, but it says showing off God's strength in you. Showing off God's strength in you. How many know in New Zealand we've got this thing called tall poppy syndrome, where we try and shut down everyone that gets a big head, everyone that tries to be awesome, tries to do something great. They actually get shut down. Why? Because we don't like showing off that side. And in pride, and when there's pride involved, yeah, let's shut people down because pride is not a good thing. But actually, God flexing our faith comes from a place of humility. It comes from a place where it's not me, God, but it's you. Have you ever seen someone, you know, you pray for someone and then they say, man, I just got healed. And you're like, it wasn't me, it was God. You know, that's the sort of space that God wants us in, where we're humble enough to know that it wasn't us at all. It wasn't us. It was actually all God working in and through us. And so we're going to open up this whole series around Flex Your Faith, because we've been, over the last month, going deeper. But we can't just continue to live deeper just for ourselves. We need to live deeper for other people as well. Those people in our worlds that don't know Him yet, the people in your family that are struggling, the people at the supermarkets that are struggling, we need to actually go deeper for them as well. And so it's a direct ongoing from our deeper series is this whole thing of having our faith on display. What does your faith on display look like? First, what is your faith? Do you have faith? I've found that if you don't have muscles, you can't flex them, right? And so if you don't have faith, you can't flex that either. And so how can we build faith? If you chuck up the first slide of what is flex, what is the meaning of this word flex? The meaning of the word flex is to tighten a muscle, or show off what you've got. To show off what you've got. How many like a show off? I got told that as a kid so many times. Oh, you're just such a show off. You're just such a show off. But isn't that what God has called us to do? Show off what God is doing in us and through us. Hasn't He called us to show it off? Aren't we called to be a light on the hill? Aren't we called to be, you know, all these things, the salt and light, the salt of the earth, bringing the God flavors in the world? God has actually called us to do that. So let's not shut each other down. Let's not shut each other down when we're trying to just show off God's goodness. I like to flex my own self because God made this. Did you know that? God made this. Just tell your neighbor and look at them and go, God made this. Like, God wants to show you off. God wants to do great things in and through you, not just for you, but for the people around you. And so this word flex, it's about to flex a muscle. It's also to show off what you've got. And then if we look at the word faith, the meaning of faith is to have complete trust or confidence in something. To have complete trust, to have complete confidence. Is that what your faith looks like? Do you have complete trust in God right now? Do you have complete confidence that your situation is going to turn around? Do you have complete confidence that God is a good God? That He's not there to harm you, but He's actually there to give you a hope and a future? Do you have full, complete trust, full, complete faith that God is awesome? Because as soon as we say on stage that God is awesome, you'll be like, haven't seen it. I don't actually believe that, or I haven't seen that for myself, so I don't know if that's true. But I believe God wants to show Himself off. God wants to show Himself true to you. He wants to show Himself good. Why? Because people in the world want good. They want great. They want awesome. They don't always get great. They don't always get good. They don't always get awesome until you show up. And the God in you is great, good, awesome. And so what does it look like to show your faith? Show off your faith. Have complete confidence in what God is doing in you. I was struggling a bit this week looking at this one scripture because I've always sort of battled the concept of how of what this scripture looked like. It's actually in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, and you might know it. It's actually going back to the King James Version. So we're going to chuck it up on the screen, if you've got that one. Here it is. So now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. When you first hear that, it's almost like a tongue twister or a brain teaser, and you think, what the heck does that even mean? I mean, I was Friday night, I think. I was trying to go to sleep, and I couldn't go to sleep till 2 a.m. because I was just boggled by this verse. And so I started looking at the Greek version, the Greek words, and all those sorts of things in there, because that's what you do as a great pastor. You bring out some Greek or Hebrew, But God has been speaking. I didn't do it just as a cliche, but God's been speaking to me about these two words that are in there. Now, faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If we look at the word substance, if you chuck up that next one, see the substance in the Greek, it's this word. Anyone want to pronounce that? Hypostasis. Hypostasis. Right, the Greek word, it means a substructure or a foundation. So faith is the foundation of things that we hope for. So without faith, we can't actually get what we hope for. We can't actually pray for great things without faith. So therefore, without faith, we can do nothing, right? We hear scriptures like that. And so when I started looking at this word substance and replacing it with the word foundation, what is the foundation? Before you can build anything, you've got to lay a great foundation, right? Before you build a new house, you've got to lay the foundation first. You don't build the second story and then put the first story and then put some foundation in. No, we've got to actually get into the foundations, because when there's an earthquake, if the foundations aren't set, then the house can topple over, right? And so how many know in life earthquakes can happen, right? Earthquakes can happen. Life throws things at us, and if our foundations aren't set, if our faith isn't the foundation of our Christianity, then our whole life can fall over. Therefore, that's why you find people that come to church and they're around for a while and then they disappear. Because at some point they haven't laid a foundation that when the earth starts to shake, when life starts to shake, they topple over. That's why we've got to get our foundation sorted. Your foundation needs to be vital in your walk with Christ, in your godly walk. The second word in this scripture is the word evidence. If we look at evidence, there's a Greek word, elenkos. That's it. That's how I want to pronounce it, so that's how it is. The evidence is the proof, the testing, and the conviction. So the evidence of things not seen, the evidence, what is the evidence? It is the testing. So if you chuck up that next one, and we'll just replace those words in here. So now faith is the foundation of things that we hope for. It's the testing of things not seen. There's actually a testing time that takes place for our faith. When your faith is tested, you either sink or you swim. When your faith is tested, that is where life actually happens. Where all those things you've learned in Sunday school start to happen. Don't build your house on the sandy land. Don't build your house on the shore. Why? Because it might seem kind of nice, but you'll have to build it twice. Because you'll have to build your house one more. You've got to build your house upon the rock. Build a firm foundation on a solid rock. The storms may come and go, but the peace of God you'll know. Man, wow. But in Sunday school, I learned you don't build your house on sand because it's going to fall over. You build it on a rock. What is God, Jesus talks to Peter in the gospel and he talks about how no one's told you this other than your own conviction. God told you this yourself. And so our firm foundation has got to be the conviction that God is good. We've got to have faith that can move mountains. We've got to have faith that can sustain us, that can actually hold us firm so that we don't topple over. Amen? See, faith means to have complete trust and confidence in something or someone. And our faith as Christians, that we've got complete trust and complete confidence in our God. We've got complete confidence that Jesus, God's only Son, got sent so that we can have freedom. That is our confidence this morning, so that we can have freedom. Are you free? Do you live a free life? Do you have faith that can be on display? Because as I said earlier, if you don't have the muscle, you can't flex it. If you don't have faith, you won't be able to flex it. But God wants to show himself off through your life. We look at this other scripture that Jesus is talking to his disciples in Matthew 21, verse 21 and 22. It says this: "Then Jesus told them, 'I tell you the truth, if you have faith and don't doubt, you can do things like this and much more.'" We've read scriptures of what Jesus had done through his time. And Jesus promises that if we have faith and don't doubt, you can do things like this and much more. You can even say to this mountain, "May you be lifted up and thrown into the sea," and it will happen. And it will happen. You can pray for anything, and if you have faith, you will receive it. So faith is a vital part of our Christianity, of our walk with Christ. Why? Because if we don't have faith, then we can't do anything. If we don't have a foundation, we can't do anything. And so now faith is that, as the foundation of what we hope for. What are your dreams? What are your aspirations? What do you want to do in life? I love what I continue to say in our church, that if you're still breathing, God hasn't finished with you yet. Yes, maybe you've been in ministry for years and years and years, but God hasn't finished with you yet. Why? Because you haven't stopped breathing. So what is the next step that you're taking towards God? Rather than just taking a step back and going, "Oh, yeah, let's let the young ones run for it." No. Why? Because God wants to change every heart, change every life. If we all just take a step towards Jesus, man, this world would be a better place. If we had faith that was unshakable, and that it was on display, man, who's going to see? It's a good challenge for all of us. Your Christianity, who's seeing it at the moment? Or are they just seeing your hurt? They're just seeing your brokenness when you're outside this? Because we see your Christianity. We see you like, "Yeah, I love Jesus." And then you go to work and it's like, where did my Christianity go? Did I leave it on Sunday? No, because your Christianity needs to be on display every day of the week, every moment, every tick of the second on the clock. Your faith needs to be on display. Why? Because there's a hurting generation, there's a hurting and broken people out there that need you on display. James chapter 1 verse 3 says this: "For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." It's only when your faith is tested that endurance starts building. Endurance. You can run long distance. If you run out of breath, you can only do a short distance. But God wants us in for the long haul. He wants us to run the race. Wants us to push through. "For you know that when your faith is tested, your endurance has a chance to grow." James chapter 2 verse 17 says this: So you see, faith by itself isn't enough unless it produces good deeds. It is dead and useless." So unless your faith is on display, unless your faith is active, then it's useless. It's like having a chest full of gold and never opening it. And it just sitting there. And when people come round, people are like, "What's in the chest?" You're like, "Nothing. Don't touch my chest." But the moment you open a chest and there's gold in there, people are amazed. Wow, that's amazing. And sometimes we just want to keep our faith and locked up. But actually the truth is, if you just opened your faith at work, if you opened your faith with your friends, on the rugby field, on the netball court, whatever games you want to play, chess, I don't know. But if you just opened your faith, people would be amazed. We hear stories like Jin on the couch. What? That's amazing. That's testifying to the goodness of God. And what testimonies, they prophesy to our future that it's going to get better. That God is weaving all the details together. That our faith is the foundation of that. But if we don't have the foundation, we have nothing. Faith without deeds is dead. Faith without works. So in order to flex our faith, we need to be doing something. It's not enough just to turn up to church. It's a good thing to do. But it's not enough. Why? Because we express ourselves in the awe we have for God. I love the word awful. Because we need to redefine the word awful. Why? Awful means full of awe. So you're awful this morning. Our God is awful. Why? Because he's full of awe. And a lot of us, we look at that word and think, you're awful. And we think, oh, that's not a compliment. But I want to tell you, it is a compliment this morning. Our God is awful. He's full of awe. Messing with your mind this morning. See, if you don't have the muscles, you won't be able to flex it. If you don't have faith, you won't be able to flex it. What does your faith look like? I can explain it a little bit in terms of exercise, going to the gym, because when you talk about muscles, that's what bodybuilders do. We've got CJ, he's a personal trainer. You can tell that he's been working on his muscles. But in order to get muscles, you need to diet and exercise. Two of the worst things in the world, right? Diet and exercise. What's diet about? If we put diet up there. If we look at the word diet, it's about what you feed yourself. Is that not the same with our walk with Christ? What are you putting into yourself? I'm constantly thinking about that with our children. What are we feeding them? What are we, not just in terms of what they're eating, but actually what is going into their small brains that is teaching them life lessons that as parents we need to step up and really decide this is what our kids are going to be like. Because we all know pastors' kids, they're a little bit naughty. Yeah? Any pastors' kids in the room? Yeah. But it's all about what you feed yourself. If all you're doing is eating donuts all week and not doing that sort of stuff, what's going to happen? You're going to turn into a donut. You're going to look like one. But if you get the right nutrition, if you get the right balance of your diet, you can actually slim down so much nicer. I'm not saying be a physical bodybuilder, but be a spiritual one. Because God wants us to be spiritually bodybuilders, that we're actually got our faith on display so much. And firstly, it's about what you feed yourself. What are you putting into yourself? Are you listening to worship? Are you reading his word? Are you listening to podcasts? Are you getting outside your think? If you think, oh, is that right? Anything I say, you can challenge, but go do some research. I'm just telling you what God's told me. Sometimes I'm going to be wrong. Hopefully not any time. Why? Because my humanity can jump in place. I want to be fully up here as God's child, as a servant. But sometimes I can read scriptures for myself and take it out of context. But what are you feeding yourself? Today you're at a smorgasbord and I'm just throwing out things that you can eat. What are you feeding yourself during the week? What are you getting into your soul, into your spirit? What are you telling your spirit? Come on, come alive this morning. Sometimes our soul is just like, oh, I don't want to get up this morning. I don't want to go to work. Tell your soul, it's time to get up. It's time to come alive. There's people out there that need to see my face today. They need to see my faith on display. Face and faith sound like a lisp. They need to see your faith today. The second thing is exercise. Exercise is about shredding off that unwanted weight, unneeded weight, and building body mass. It's about slimming down. All those weights that easily entangle you, all those things that are going to slow you down, shred them off because they're unneeded, they're unwanted. Hopefully you're not feeling too convicted about spiritually. No, actually, hopefully you are. Because physically, what we feed ourselves affects our physical appearance. What you feed yourself spiritually affects your spiritual appearance. If you're not exercising during the week, your spiritual walk with Christ, on Sunday, people are like, I heard you pray that same prayer last week. Have you only got one prayer in your vocabulary? Why? Because we hold on to one thing and we think, yep, we're just going to carry on with that. But there's a whole array of different exercises you can do in the kingdom to get closer to God, to build spiritual muscles. So lastly, I'm just going to get Karen up. In order to flex your faith, you need to throw off every weight and feed yourself the right things. In order to flex your faith, you need to throw off every weight and feed yourself the right things. What is unnecessary? What are the things that you're holding on to that actually don't matter right now? What is the hurt, the bitterness, the offense, the sorrow, all the things that you've just been highlighting after so many years that God wants to replace with joy? He wants to replace it with strength. He wants to replace it with wholeness. See, if you're broken in this place, join the club. We're all broken. None of us are Jesus. We're trying to be like Jesus, but we're not Jesus. We're not perfect. But I pray that during the week, you're doing some spiritual exercises, that you're doing some spiritual dieting and watching the movies that you watch, watching the shows that you watch. Over lockdown, I'm the same. I put on some unwanted kgs during lockdown. Why? Because I just let everything go. It was just like, oh well, I'm not going to see anyone for 8 weeks. I'll just, in the last week, do some exercise and hopefully it comes off. It's like, no, we have to be intentional. Why? Because you eat more when you're at home. You don't exercise as much because you can't. You don't feel like it. You binge watch Netflix shows. But all that stuff's not helpful physically. So why do we think it's okay spiritually not to exercise and not to diet during the week? I hope it's challenging you as much as it's been challenging me for the last couple of weeks. Because I really want to live a life that shows the display of how good God is. How amazing our God is. It's hard to talk to someone that is preaching out of disappointment. And when I say preaching, it's not on a stage with a mic. It's just a conversation at home. It's just a conversation at work. Why? Because you're preaching when you're there. That is your platform. That is your stage. Don't limit preaching to someone standing on the stage that you have to listen to. Flexing your faith means that you are the preacher. Your life is on display. I love the picture of the cross when Jesus hanging there. Why? Because his life was on display. He was there. He was beaten. He was half naked. Everything was on show there. So in order to actually have our faith on display, we need to get vulnerable. We need to strip off all those things that are holding us back, and we need to feed ourselves the right things. So you've got opportunities to flex your faith this week. Someone's sick, you can see them healed. If you've got a poverty mindset, try tithing, because it will break something over you. If you're single, you can be married over time, not instant, right? Putting it out there. If you're barren, you can have children. Let's not live in this side of the label where we're sick and constantly live there. Let's live in the prosperity of God, in the favor of God, in the blessing of God, that we are healed in Jesus' name. We are healed in Jesus' name. You are more than a conqueror. You can do greater things than all the disciples in the Bible, all the stories that you read in the Bible of, man, that's amazing. You can do amazinger things. That's actually a word. Yeah, that's right. Told you learn something new every day. But what's it going to take to have your faith on display? Have the people around you know that you're a Christian. And not just the happy, clappy Christian that everyone thinks. I had to change the mindsets of my workmates because they thought church was just a funeral. You turn up, you sit in the pews, you be quiet, you listen to hymns, you listen to an old man preach something, and then you go home. Who wants to go to church? That's their mindset. They came into our church and were like, well, this is like a nightclub, man. What are you guys doing? Why? Because we're changing the culture of what people think. It's not as it is. It's not changing church in a way that we're bringing heavy metal to church and this is the devil music and all that sort of stuff. It's making it relevant for people to understand that there's a God in heaven that loves every single one of us. Our God cares for you so much. And there's greater things in store for you than what you're currently living in. Amen? Awesome. Why don't you stand to your feet? I love the song, God of Revival. That word, come awaken your people. Come awaken your people. What a statement. We can still be God's people and be asleep. Being asleep or awake, you're still God's child. But being awake means you can do something great. You can do so much more things rather than sleeping on the couch. So all over this place, why don't you just close your eyes? And if you can relate to any of that, I just want you to lift your hands because I'd love to pray for you this morning. That whether you're feeding yourself the wrong thing spiritually, whether you're not exercising your faith during the week, your life is on display. Whether you like it or not, the moment you responded to Jesus, your life started to be on display. You're not called to fit in, you're called to stand out. You're called to be on display. Your faith needs to be flexed. So, Father, right now, for every single one of us, Lord, where we've got complacent, where we've got a little bit lazy in our Christianity, God, I just pray for your Holy Spirit right now to touch every area. God, that I can speak different things, but it's not until your Spirit moves, Lord God, that things start to change. So God, let it not just change in our minds today, and let it not change in our brains, but let it change in our heart, Lord God. Let something of the nature of heaven touch every heart right now, God. Only you know the desires of our heart. Only you know the things that are going on in the unseen right now, Lord God. So do what only you can do, Lord God. Thank you, Jesus. You know, during the week, I saw this quote from Brian Houston, who leads Hillsong. He said this, "Your actions are what people see. Your motives are what God sees." Your actions are what people see, but your motives, the reason you're doing something, only God can see that. Man, that was challenging. Man, that is convicting. Because we can't see why you're doing something, why you're up. I had to go through the hard way of why I was up on stage worship leading, because it was all about me. I didn't want to show God off, I want to show myself off. And God humbled me to a point where I'm like, God, I don't want to stand up on a stage. But God says, no, I need to flex something in you. I need to show off my goodness. I want to show off through you what the world is missing right now. And so it's going to need every single one of us to step up and step out a lot more. Amen. Come on, let's give God a clap of praise for that.